name is Michelle Holland, and I would like to welcome you into the Truth in Science family. During this brief tutorial, I hope to introduce you to the how and why of our distinctive curriculum, how the curriculum works, and why understanding the impact of worldview on education, particularly science, is imperative. Having taught high school biology for 10 years, and also believing the Bible to be the foundation of truth, I've seen firsthand how modern evolutionary science has destroyed people's faith in the Bible, especially the book of Genesis. We at Truth in Science believe we have created a science curriculum that, for the first time in modern history, has achieved a proper integration of biblical truth, worldview understanding, and good science. The Truth in Science curriculum consists of four separate components. One, the teacher's edition. Two, the student steps. Three, the support illustration package available for download on our website. And four, the quizzes and tests, including answer keys. So let's take a look at this new approach to science education, beginning with the teacher's edition. The TE has been specifically designed to facilitate teaching. You will see this reflected in the layout of the material and also in the support material included to enhance the teacher's understanding of the worldview positions incorporated into each subject. Let me encourage you to take the time to go through the material included in the front of the textbook. Because of the uniqueness of this approach to science education, it will help you get a proper foundational understanding for the rest of the content. After thumbing through the table of contents, you will find a heartfelt dedication written by our editor-in-chief, Dr. G. Thomas Sharp, to Dr. Henry Morris, who has been recognized as the father of the modern biblical creationist movement. It is his tenets of biblical creation and tenets of scientific creation that were the guiding principles for this curriculum. Next, you will encounter the TIS editorial staff. We hope that you are assured by the credentials of our personnel, as well as those of our reviewers, that this curriculum contains thoroughly sound science information and educational methods. The TIS staff is aware of the many different approaches to time scheduling in various educational settings. We've dealt with this reality by giving suggested schedules which reflect optional time modifications. The staff was also attentive to the scientific integrity of the curriculum. One of the most overused and patently false sentiments is that science deals with reality while religion deals with faith. The supposed separation of science and faith has been successfully advanced by modern evolutionary scientists, though their own beliefs rest in faith. The TIS staff believes that good science is founded in a proper worldview, so they cannot and should not be separated. As you can see, those under your teaching will receive a complete and solid science education through this curriculum. As is typical in most science textbooks, you'll find that we've included a section on safety guidelines. Here you will find protocol not only for safe scientific investigation, but also for safe conduct while in the field or on field trips. The next and longest section you will encounter in your teacher's edition is called Our Educational Philosophy. It is here that you will gain the greatest understanding for what makes this curriculum unique among all other Christian science curricula, why we've undertaken to produce it, and how the impact of worldview will be integrated into each lesson. In this section, you'll be introduced to various concepts that are generally not addressed, such as evidence versus interpretation, what is a biblical worldview, along with other sections such as treatment of content and how to use truth in science. At the risk of sounding overdramatic, please do not be put off by the length of this section. It is very important to your foundational understanding as a teacher of this curriculum. Last, but by no means least, we've printed for you the tenets of biblical and scientific creation. As was mentioned earlier, these were created by Dr. Henry Morris and the Institute for Creation Research and reflect a solid biblical understanding of the creation around us. To the best of our knowledge, there is no other creation-based science curriculum written around these tenets. Now we're ready to move into the lesson material. I think you'll really be excited as you begin to see what this can do for your students. One of the first things you probably noticed as you thumbed through the table of contents was that the first chapter is not what most would consider to be a science subject, worldview. This just shows how we as Christians have accepted the evolutionary separation of science and faith without thinking. In every grade level of truth in science, the first chapter will introduce the concept of worldview. As you turn to the first page of the first chapter, you see it laid out in three sections. The sidebar on the outside edge of each page is called Teacher's Commentary. The section located at the bottom of each page is called the Tab section, and the large rectangular section in the middle of each page is the lesson content material. At the beginning of each chapter, you will encounter the planning guide, which will show you the lesson titles and their sequence, as well as the objectives and activities for each. Furthermore, you will also notice that the Tab section on this first page reflects the individual tenets from the biblical and scientific tenets of creation, which will be covered in that particular chapter. On the next page, the planning guide continues with a list of the vocabulary words as they are introduced into each section, the illustrations needed to support the lesson, and the materials required by the teacher and students, if any, for the lesson. Having now discussed the planning guide, let's return to the formatting of the lesson material. First, let's discuss the teacher's commentary. In the teacher's commentary section, you will find remarks relevant to the worldview aspects of the particular lesson being taught. If there are any evolutionary issues directly tied to a particular lesson subject, you should find commentary addressing this fact. Sometimes, however, the commentary will take a more general approach to the worldview impact. For instance, in the presentation on the planning guide pages, the commentary will address the general implications that worldview has for the chapter's subject matter. Thus, in the remarks included alongside of the planning guide for chapter worldview, we find information regarding the subject of intelligent design. Intelligent design can be a double-edged sword, for while the concept recognizes that the world around us is too complex for a random or chance explanation, what it does not and will not do is allow for the definition of that design to be solely tied to the God of the Bible. Therefore, intelligent design can lead one to believe in another supernatural explanation for our universe. This is a worldview issue, for our Creator was very explicit. He will have no other gods before Him. Because of this informational layout, we suggest that the teacher spend time internalizing the content in the teacher's commentary section before moving on to the lesson planning stage. The tab material at the bottom of the page has been included to further enhance your understanding of the general lesson material and to provide you with pertinent and/or little-known facts about the subject matter. This section has been formatted to look like an index card file, with the individual subjects being evolution says, interesting facts, notable quotes, faith or fact, and a section for your own notes. Let's look at these sections one at a time. Evolution says is a section dedicated to understanding what the evolutionary philosophy would be regarding a certain subject. It is designed to accomplish at least two purposes. One, to show how familiar concepts embraced by most of us are actually evolutionary in their basis, and two, to alert you and therefore your students to some of the tactics and wording that evolutionists employ to persuade unsuspecting students to embrace their philosophy. Most of the time, we will show you the fallacy of their various positions. Interesting facts are just that, interesting and usually little-known facts about the chapter's subject matter. While not always pertinent to a specific day's lesson, it will always be connected in some way to the chapter's subject. Notable quotes is a section where we list for you quotations from notable people or about a notable position. Here you will find quotes from both creationists and evolutionists, atheists and Christians. We include them so that you may see some of the stark differences in the two positions of worldview, and to show you how our common enemy, the devil, works in the minds of men to accomplish his purposes. Faith or fact is a section that deals specifically with the understanding that much of what is presented as scientific fact, as defined by the scientific method of investigation, is in reality a position of faith. One of the greatest misconceptions in this debate of creation versus evolution is that evolution is fact-based and creation is faith-based. The things revealed in this section will blow that assertion out of the water. Finally, we've included a substantial amount of note room both in the tab section and in other blank areas of the curriculum. This will lessen the possibility of you having to keep volumes of loose papers containing your notes in your TE. Having now discussed the general format of the content pages, let's look at a typical chapter layout. Each chapter has 10 lessons. These are broken into 5 interactive lessons, which you teach, 2 lab activities or demonstrations, and 1 chapter project. Lesson 9 has 3 components, a worldview quiz, a game which reinforces the chapter material, and a review for the lesson 10 subject test. Every chapter's first lesson introduces the chapter subject, yet its format differs from the remaining lessons. The primary goal is to establish a biblical worldview approach for the subject matter while presenting information needed for the rest of the chapter. You also may introduce the chapter project, assigning each student his or her project to be completed by Lesson 8 for presentation to the class. Or, if you prefer, you may assign the project during Lesson 8, but you will need to allow a modicum of time for the students to prepare their presentations. And finally, a distinctive of Lesson 1 is the student's KWL chart. KWL stands for I Know, I Wonder, and I Learned. This is how it works. During this first lesson, have the students choose one word from the vocabulary list that they would like to learn more about. They will put this word in the I know box and tell briefly what they already know about this word. Then, in the I wonder box, they will list questions they have about their word. As you progress through the chapter material, the students are then encouraged to gather information about their word, answer as many of their questions as they can, and record their answers in the I learned box. This is a great tool to help students manage their own learning, and it can also be collected as a grade at the chapter's end, if so desired. Having discussed the difference between the first lesson and the rest of the lessons, let's look at a typical lesson. The first page of each lesson will be the lesson organizer page. On this page, you will find several important items. In addition to the teacher's commentary and the tab sections, you should find 1, the chapter's bedrock, one or more sentences that state the chapter's teaching in a nutshell. 2, the chapter's memory verse, a pertinent Bible verse which shows up on both the worldview quiz and chapter test. 3, the chapter's objectives and activities. 4, any materials needed by the teacher to complete the lesson. And 5, any materials required by the student to complete the lesson. The next page begins the teaching section of the chapter. This section is called Teach and Apply. At the beginning of each lesson, you will again be made aware of the illustrations needed to teach this lesson and what your students will need. The actual teaching material is set up in a 3-part sequence: ask, answer, teach. Each lesson will give you step-by-step instructions on how to proceed in your task. The teacher begins with a question regarding the subject material. After allowing the students to discuss possible answers, the teacher will give them the correct answer and proceed to teach the supporting information. It's important that the teacher allow the students to engage in discussion before giving the answer and instruction. This will show how the students think as well as what they think. Each lesson will have at least 1 ask, answer, teach segment. Some have more, depending on the subject. Incorporated into this sequence will be activities for the students to participate in using their step workbooks. We'll discuss the step books in a moment. This first section of Teach and Apply will be primarily interested in viewing the subject material from a worldview understanding. This may sound complicated, but it's really quite simple. Our primary purpose in this curriculum is to present good, solid science from a biblical worldview perspective. So in this section, you will find some scientific positions taken that are diametrically opposed to the public evolutionary science position. Let me be very clear, we do not present any biblical faith-driven positions as being verifiable scientific positions, which is what is done many times in secular science classes. But we want to show how the scientific evidence can align with a biblical interpretation just as easily, or more easily, than an evolutionary one. However, we have not neglected the fact that for those who desire to attend college, it will be necessary to perform well on standardized tests and college entrance exams. Therefore, we've included a segment in each of the 5 interactive lessons called Science Instruction. In this second segment, we will include brief, concise science teaching that will incorporate any evolutionary bias science that the student would be required to know in order to pass those tests. Finally, so that we can ensure that the student has had ample opportunity to ingest this content well, there is a fill-in-the-blank activity at the end of each of those 5 lessons, which reinforces the secular science in the science instruction. Lesson 2 will always be a demonstration or activity dealing with the chapter's subject matter. These will be simple, yet enticing to the students, and should provide many teachable moments. As might be expected, the format for this lesson will deviate somewhat from the 5 interactive lessons. Lesson 7 is the designated lab chapter. In this chapter, you and your students will explore some facet of God's creation through the process of scientific investigation. And just so you will know how to do this, the lab for chapter 1 is What is the Scientific Method? It is here where your students will learn how to conduct the rest of their lab activities. Furthermore, to enhance your ability to direct your students, you will find the information and/or directions from their step listed in your TE in blue font. This way, you will have all of that lesson's information at your fingertips. Lesson 8 is our Report to You project, the at-home research project that allows the students to do a little research, create a report, and bring the results back to share with the class. Ideally, this project would be assigned during Lesson 1, and the whole Lesson 8 time can be spent in reporting back to you. But if you opt to wait until Lesson 8 to make your assignments, you will need to either allow them more time to complete this task, or you will need to modify what you want them to do. As was already mentioned, lessons 9 and 10 are review and assessment lessons. Quizzes and tests are in your packet, while answer keys are a separate document in your packet. In Lesson 9, you will administer the OpenNote Worldview Quiz. You may also have the students participate in a classroom game where they answer questions that you have formed from the chapter content and test. You may, of course, decide to opt out of this activity, but you will want to include some type of material review for the upcoming Lesson 10 chapter assessment. You can certainly do this and the game if you would like. Finally, in Lesson 10, you will administer the one thing all students long for, the chapter test. We've now covered the majority of the Truth in Science Teacher's Edition. In the back of the text, you will find a glossary listing all of the vocabulary words and their respective chapters. Furthermore, you will find an index containing many of the important words contained in the TE. So let's move on now to the student step, the other half of this exciting new approach to science education. The student steps are individual student texts that include all of the information contained in the TE's Teach and Apply section, along with all of the student activities required for each lesson. For the most part, the only difference between the TE and student steps is that the steps do not contain any of the commentary material or any of the tab material, though some of it is slipped in. Each step contains 25 to 30 pages of science education, including the evolutionary science they need to pass secular tests. The flexibility built into the student steps is not new to Christian Science curricula, but the inclusion of worldview integrated science, along with this flexibility, makes it immediately rank among the best creation science student textbooks around. Truth in Science student steps were created to serve as a standalone science curriculum. By that, we mean that there is no science taught in the Teacher's Edition teaching segments that is not included in the steps written on the student's level. Therefore, a student can work his or her way through a given step independently and learn good, solid science while also receiving proper worldview understanding of the biblical interpretation. However, when combined with the additional insights related to the teacher by the commentary and tabs material, the student who completes the Truth in Science program will truly be a step ahead. Each step is formatted to reflect the material in the TE. Each lesson's first page will give the student, one, an outline of what they will be studying, and two, a vocabulary list. Teachers, please note, the vocabulary list on the first page will contain all of the words the student will be tested on, plus there may be a few more. There is no set pattern. For instance, 10 words on the list, 7 words on the test. So the student would be well advised to be familiar with all of the words and their meanings. Additionally, the student will find the chapter's bedrock and memory verse on this page. As an added feature, each step has many more illustrations than are in the TE. Many of the illustrations used as support for the teacher will appear in the student step as well. The KWL chart and matching vocabulary list appear in the first lesson too. As a side note, since the Report to You project is recommended to be assigned during Lesson 1, this assignment appears in Lesson 1 of the step. If you should opt to forgo this assignment until Lesson 8, be sure your students know your intentions. And finally, the student will find respective science journal pages on which he or she may record the findings of the activities in Lessons 2 and 7. These steps have been formatted and produced in such a way that the books themselves can be turned in for grading and returned to the student to proceed on to the next lesson. Their name can be written in the space provided on the back cover. Well, that about does it. Don't forget that there are supporting illustrations available to help you as you teach. They can be used as handouts or transparencies as you deem appropriate. These illustrations can be downloaded from the Truth in Science website for free. Before I leave you, I would like to say thank you for joining our family. We, the staff at Truth in Science, the writers, the editors, and myself, have a burden for those of you who are attempting to bring up a child in the way he should go, so when he is old, he will not depart from it. We know the forces that are formed against you. There are many out there who believe we cannot recover what has been lost. We are not convinced. We believe that as we begin to systematically reshape our society's worldview to once again reflect the Bible one family at a time, we can expect God's blessings upon our endeavors. It is with this hope that we are honored to bring to you the Truth in Science curriculum. God bless you and your students.
Lift up your voice and